Welcome to Finished Work International Ministries, a ministry that is on the cutting edge, changing lives around the world. As you let God in today and apply the word, expect a divine encounter and supernatural transformation.
It is impossible for you to be defeated when you have the revelation of the will of God. It is impossible for situations to subdue you when you walk in understanding of what God is saying to you.
Let the finished work of Jesus determine what you pray.
When God is your source, you don't look back. You keep looking forward. You keep trusting. God, I trust you.
Here's Apostle Faithman Ogboada.
Glory be to God. Hallelujah. This is the day the Lord has made. We'll rejoice and be glad. You're welcome to the Supernatural School of Healing and Deliverance. Well, you know, when some people hear the word deliverance, some people in some Christian circle, they just push, it takes them off. But the word deliverance is not a wrong word. Jesus delivered people. Jesus break yokes in the lives of people, and Jesus brought people into freedom. And the will of God for the New Testament believers is to function from freedom. And this freedom is a product of the finished work of Jesus. This freedom is a product of the finished work of Jesus. The finished work of Jesus has become the foundation of the New Testament believer. The foundation of the New Testament believer is the finished work of Jesus. So in this school of healing and deliverance, there are certain things we are going to study in this class, and the Holy Ghost will begin to help us, to minister to us, to show us that we can minister the healing power of God to people, and we can also minister the deliverance power of God to people who are bound, who are head bound by one force of the enemy or the other. We can break yokes in the lives of people. People can be delivered from addictions. You know, there are people who are addicted to cocaine. They are addicted to cocaine. They need to be delivered from that. There are people who are addicted to pornography. There are those who are addicted to masturbation. They are God's people. Some of them are born again. Some of them are sons of God and daughters of God. There are people who are addicted to alcohol. They are addicted to things that is hurting them. Those people need to be delivered from those things. So the word deliverance is not a wrong word. It's just that a lot of people have misused the word. A lot of people have abused the manifestation of the things of the Spirit. And that is why most people don't really, okay, I don't believe in deliverance, you know, because most people don't have the true revelation of what it means to enforce their liberty, what it means to enforce their liberty in Christ Jesus. So this school will be getting us ready for we to begin to understand that the life of the Spirit is important. The life of dominion is important. We are looking at the life of Jesus. We saw how Paul was able to speak the power of God over people and how they got delivered from certain situations that held them bound. So we are to become the carriers of God's power. We are to be the people that will manifest the power of God, that wherever we find ourselves, we're expected to bring the kingdom of God into the place. And we'll bring the kingdom of God is not just in word, but also in power. It's in power. There has to be visitation of the Spirit. There have to be the release of the Spirit. There have to be manifestation of the Holy Ghost that will change the lives of people, that will empower people to move in freedom, to walk in freedom. This is the will of God. If the gospel is preached and not being demonstrated, we have not preached it. People need to see the power of God. People need to be free. You know, Jesus saw that woman that was bound for 18 years. He said, the spirit of infirmity has held her bound for 18 years. And he ministered the power of God to that woman and cast out that spirit away from her. And that woman was free. You know, so freedom is the will of God. There are a lot of people bound today They're in church, they're Christians, bound, going through so many situations that they need to be delivered from. They need to be free from those things that the enemy has put on them. We are new creations in Christ Jesus. We are not expected to be captive. We are not expected to bow to any form of satanic manipulation or deception. But if there is someone who is struggling from any problem, from any situation, they are addicted to it and they are born again, they have the right to take freedom, to enjoy freedom. So today in this supernatural school of healing and deliverance, we're going to start with teaching on the finished work of Jesus. When God sent us Jesus, He sent His will our way. When God gave us Jesus, He gave us the perfect picture that we should focus on. Jesus is the perfect picture, and what Jesus have done should decide our thinking. Jesus is the perfect picture, and what Jesus have done should decide our thinking, should decide how we function and how we operate. The finished work of Jesus actually is the foundation for our faith work. You know, our work of faith cannot be effective except we depend and trust in what Jesus have already done. Our work of faith begins with what Jesus have already done. If a believer lacks a revelation of what Jesus have already done, he or she cannot enforce their dominion, cannot enforce their victory, cannot enforce what Jesus have already done for them. So we need the revelation of what Jesus have done for we to walk in power, to flow in power, and to see the miraculous all the time. So today we're looking at the finished work of Jesus. I like us to look at this scripture in John Gospel chapter 10 verse 10. Let's hear from Jesus in John Gospel 10 verse 10. Oh, glory be to God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In John Gospel 10 verse 10, and look at what he said here. He said, "The thief cometh not but to steal." Why is the thief coming? He comes to steal. Jesus was sharing, said, "The thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy." This is the assignment of Satan. Wherever Satan shows up, he wants to do that. He wants to steal. And someone may ask a question, what does he want to steal? The most important thing Satan wants to steal from people is the word of God. The most important thing that Satan wants to steal from people is the word of God. If you look at Mark Gospel chapter 4 and look at the parable that Jesus was talking about, the sower, and how he explained that parable, he talked about the word of God is the seed that was sown, and when the word was sown, people received it with gladness, and you know, immediately Satan came and took that word away from them. Satan came immediately and took the word away from them. So the major challenge of Satan today is when he sees people receiving the word of God, believing the word of God, declaring the word of God, living from the word of God. That is a major challenge of Satan. So he doesn't want people to function from the word of God, because he understands the potential, the energy, and the power that flows from the word of God. So what he wants to do is to make you doubt the integrity of the word of God, is to make you not to believe the reality of the word of God, is to make you to look at God's word from a perspective that is in opposition to the power in the word of God. He doesn't want you to place value on God's word. He understands the power. He understands the efficacy of the word of God. But he doesn't want you to place value on the word. That is why he comes immediately to take the word away from you. Because when the word of God is taken away from someone, they have no basis for victory. They don't have foundation for victory. They don't have what it takes to speak their victory or to enforce their victory in any situation, because it takes the revelation of Jesus for you to express Jesus in any situation. I want to say that again. I said it takes the revelation of Jesus for you to express Jesus in any situation. If Jesus is going to be made manifest in any situation, I need to have the revelation of the Christ in me, which is the foundation for unlocking the supernatural. You can't truly unlock the supernatural if you don't have the revelation of the Christ in you, because that revelation will stir your faith up for greater work.
God. That revelation of the Christ in you will stir up your faith for greater works. So in John Gospel 10, verse 10, he said, "But the thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy." He said, "I am come that they might have life." This is the will of God. He said, "I have come that they might have life." So Jesus actually came for people to have life. Life as the Father has it. Life as God has it. He wants them to enjoy the God life. But you see, you can't enjoy this God life except you submit yourself to the leadership of Jesus, to submit yourself to his lordship and receive him as your Lord and Savior. That's the only way you can begin to enjoy this life, and also by walking in the knowledge of his word. So here we saw that Jesus said, "I've come that you have life and have that life more and have it more abundantly." This is the will of God, that you have life and have it more abundantly. But the question today may be this, you know, someone may say, "But I have received Jesus as my Lord and my Savior, but I don't see this life that the Bible talk about, this abundant life in manifestation." Let me say this to you. The abundant life is eternal life. Now listen, when you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are expected to grow in the knowledge of the life of God in you. If you don't have the revelation of that life of God that is in you, you cannot put that life to work. That life is greater than death. That life of God in you is greater than sickness and disease. That life of God in you is powerful than any evil spirit that may try to contend with you. But what is the essence of having a mobile phone that could solve a lot of problems for you, but you don't utilize the potential of the mobile phone? There are so many apps on people's phones that they don't utilize. They don't maximize those apps. And those apps are just that. They just use the phone to make a call or to do a text message. That's the least they could do, but they don't do other social media with those apps they have on their phones. Not that because they don't like to do it, but some of them don't know how to do it. Then some people tell you that, "Oh, I don't have an idea of all these social media things, I don't do them," you know. But the phone has the capacity to do it. The same way the life of God in you have the capacity to change any situation if you function in the revelation of that life of God that is in you. So Jesus said, "I've come that you will have life and have it more abundantly." So you are expected to enforce this abundant life in any situation. It doesn't matter what the situation is, you have the life of God in you. And you are expected to speak from the life of God. You are expected to minister from the life of God. You are expected to think from the life of God. So the finished work of Jesus actually is the foundation for manifesting the life of God. The finished work of Jesus, the knowledge of the finished work of Jesus is the foundation for manifesting the life of God, the knowledge of that life. So it is important that we begin to have the revelation of that knowledge. Let's look at this scripture in Colossians chapter 2. Hallelujah. Jesus defeated the devil. Jesus defeated Satan. And his everything that has to do with Satan was being defeated by Jesus. Now, the victory of Jesus is the victory of the New Testament believer. I said the victory of Jesus is the victory of the New Testament believer. I want to read this scripture in Colossians for you. And watch this. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In Colossians chapter 1, let's start from Colossians chapter 1. Then we're going to do Colossians chapter 2. In Colossians chapter 1, I'd like us to look at verse 12. It said here, "Giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light." We are partakers of the inheritance. So one of the things you need to understand is that you are a partaker of the inheritance. And someone may ask a question, what is the inheritance? The inheritance is the finished work of Jesus. You are a partaker. If you're born again, you are a partaker of that inheritance. But if you have no revelation that you're a partaker of that inheritance, you cannot enforce the inheritance. You cannot utilize it or maximize it or use it in your favor or to use it to be a blessing to other people. So we are partakers of the inheritance. And look at verse 13 said, he said, "Who has delivered us from the power of darkness?"
You see, whenever you're facing any situation or you're dealing with any situation, one of the key things you need to establish is your authority over the situation. You need to have the revelation of your authority over the situation. If you don't have the revelation of your authority over the situation, that situation may subdue you. And how is that situation going to subdue you? The enemy will cause you to believe that this situation is greater than you, that it's not possible to resolve this problem, it's not possible to deal with this problem, it's not possible to cast out this demon or to deal with this, whatever the situation may be in the natural for a person. You need to have this understanding that he said, who has delivered us from the power of darkness. I need to establish that. If I don't know that I'm delivered from the power of darkness, I will be submitting to the power of darkness based on ignorance, because I don't know what God's word have said. I don't know about the finished work of Jesus. So now I submit myself to demonic harassment, to demonic attack, to demonic manipulation, because I lack the revelation of what he has done for me. So here he's saying that we have been delivered from the power of darkness. So the power of darkness cannot lord it over the new creation in Christ Jesus. The new creation in Christ Jesus may come through, may see opposition, may see some attack, may see some challenges, but he has authority over it. You see, you have authority over anything that wants to come your way. Satan is no more powerful than you. Satan is not powerful than the life of God that is in you. We need to establish this point in this school. You know, you need to understand how powerful you are in Christ Jesus. So the scripture here in Colossians 1:13 said, who has delivered us from the power of darkness and have translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. This understanding is very important. If you are going to manifest the power of God, you need to have this revelation that you are in the kingdom right now. In this kingdom, there is dominion. In this kingdom, there is power. In this kingdom, there is glory. In this kingdom, every resources we need, all the spiritual resources we need to function supernaturally is available in the kingdom of God. And we'll come into those resources when we have the revelation of what God's word have said concerning them. Now, I'd like us to look at this scripture. In Colossians chapter 1 verse 9, he said, for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. He said that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will. This is very important if you're going to walk in the supernatural. The knowledge of his will is the foundation for faith work. You cannot truly be a person who is going to do faith exploits, produce uncommon results, without being filled with the knowledge of his will. The knowledge of his will, the knowledge of the will of Christ, the knowledge of the will of God is the foundation for walking in the miraculous. The miraculous begins to happen when the knowledge of his will becomes the focus of our thinking. The knowledge of his will. So in Colossians 1 verse 9, it said here that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will. So if you are going to minister the healing power of God to someone, if you are going to minister the deliverance power of God to someone, maybe someone that is addicted to witchcraft, someone that is being oppressed by evil spirits, someone that is being oppressed by wicked spirits, someone that is going through any challenge in life, if you want to minister the healing power of God to them, you must be filled with the knowledge of his will. Why? Because it takes the knowledge of his will to produce faith in you, because you need faith to express authority. You need faith to do what? To express authority. You can't truly express authority if you're not walking by faith. And faith is a product of hearing the word of God. It's a product of revelation knowledge. Faith is a product of revelation knowledge. Faith is a product of revelation knowledge. Romans 10:17, it says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That is how faith comes. So if when faith is coming to us, we're being filled, when the word of God is coming to us, we're being filled with the knowledge of his will. As you're hearing God's word, the knowledge of his will concerning healing is coming to you. The knowledge of his will concerning the deliverance is coming to you. The knowledge of his will concerning the miraculous is coming to you. The knowledge of his will concerning the manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit is coming to you. So as we hear the word of God, we come into the knowledge of his will, which becomes the foundation for the work that God has asked us to do. Because without the knowledge of his will, you cannot release the healing power of God to someone. Now, I want to show us something in the book of Acts, a practical example of what happened in Acts chapter 3. In Acts chapter 3, thank you, Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 3, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In Acts chapter 3, let's look at from verse 1. He said, now he said in Acts chapter 3 from verse 1, he said, now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask them of them that were entered into the temple, who seen Peter and John about to go into the temple, and asked them. He saw Peter and John, and he was asking for them. And Peter fastened his eyes and looked upon. And Peter fastened his eyes upon him with John, and said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. He gave heed to them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold none I have, but such as I have I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Now, he couldn't do that if he doesn't have the revelation of the name of Jesus. If he was not filled with the knowledge of his will concerning the authority, the power in the name of Jesus, he could have not released his faith towards that. Towards the name of Jesus, he said, "Silver and gold none do I have, but such as I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." This is revelation knowledge. This is revelation knowledge. A person without this revelation knowledge about the name of Jesus cannot release the healing power of God to this man who couldn't walk, who couldn't move. And he said, "In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." Verse 7 said, "And he took him by his right hand and lifted him up. Immediately his feet and ankle bone received strength." What was happening? What was Peter doing? Peter had a revelation of the name of Jesus. Peter have a revelation of what the finished work of Jesus have done. Because Jesus have done it, we can enforce it. Because Jesus have done it, we can demonstrate it. Because Jesus have done it, we can manifest it. Because Jesus have done it, we can experience it. We can experience it. So the finished work of Jesus should decide what we think, what we believe, how we act, and how we function. The finished work of Jesus. The finished work of Jesus will grant you the boldness to manifest the power of God. The boldness to minister to people who are in need. The finished work of Jesus will give you that boldness. So if I hear the revelation of what Jesus have done for me, how he defeated the devil, how he gave authority and power to the church, the authority and the power that the church of God have is to witness, is to be a witness, is to be able to manifest Jesus everywhere they go. That was why the Bible says in the book of Mark that he was confirming the word. He was confirming the word with signs and with wonder. He confirms his word, not theory, not religion, not the dogmas of men, not the thinking of men. What he confirmed is the word. So when the word of God is preached, there is going to be confirmation. He's going to confirm it with miracles, with signs and wonder. So it is important we have the revelation of the finished work of Jesus. Without the revelation of the finished work of Jesus, we cannot minister the healing power of God to people. We cannot minister deliverance to those that the enemy has bound and has held them hostage. Even they come to church, they sing in the choir. Some of them can even be preaching, but they are bound in one area of their life or the other, and they are struggling with it. They don't know how to be free. They don't know how to break free. They will do it today, and tomorrow they repent, "Lord, forgive me for my sin." And next tomorrow they come back again. They are going up, going down, going up, going down. That is not the will of God. God wants his people to be free. And freedom is a product of redemption. Freedom is a product of redemption. Freedom is a product of what Jesus has done. That was why the scripture said in Galatians 5 verse 1. It says, stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free, and don't entangle yourself again with the yoke of bondage. Paul acknowledged that people can entangle themselves again. Paul acknowledged that people can step into the yoke of bondage. That was why he said in Romans chapter 8, where he was talking about, he said, dear one, there is no more condemnation for those who are now in Christ Jesus, who do not walk after the flesh, but after the spirit. But because if a person walks after the flesh, there's going to be condemnation. If a person walks after the flesh, there's going to be condemnation. So it's not the will of God for us to walk after the flesh, because the flesh opens door for satanic manifestation, for satanic visitation, for satanic deception. Because when a person is in the flesh, they're opening door for the enemy. That was why the Bible said, if you bring the edge, the serpent is going to bite. The serpent is a symbol of Satan. It's a symbol of Satan. So when people break the edge, when sin opens door for demonic manipulation, deception, and possession, all kinds of things happen when people begin to live in sin. Have you ever met a preacher or heard about a preacher, for example, he used to be very committed to the Lord Jesus Christ, and he started living in sin to a point he came, he denied Jesus, and now you see how those demons made their ways into his life and so many things went wrong. The life of Judas Iscariot was an example of that. The Bible said, and Satan entered into Judas Iscariot. Why did Satan enter into him? Satan was just looking for someone that would be available, then he's going to express himself. And the same way it's happening today, someone, a believer, can open door for evil spirits to come into them. They can open door for demonic spirit. They can open door. This is why you see people do certain things and you're wondering, but she's born again. But he's born again. Why did that happen? Judas was with Jesus for 3 years and more, and Satan entered into him. And this is why the Bible said, guide your heart with all diligence, that out of it comes the issues of life. Guide your heart. You need to guide your heart. You don't need to open door for the enemy to take advantage of you and abuse you. Our God is a God of mercy. Our God is a God of kindness. Our God is a God of forgiveness. Our God is a God of goodness. Our God is a God of love and mercy and kindness. But never take God's kindness, God's mercy for granted, and then start living in sin. You are going to open door for all the evil spirits, and they're going to mess up your life. They're going to mess up your life. Never take the goodness of God for granted. Never take the goodness of God for granted. Never take the goodness of God for granted. So the finished work of Jesus should be the foundation in ministering healing and deliverance to people who have been bound, who have been hurted, who have been oppressed, who are going through one challenge or the other. We can speak and release the power of God into the atmosphere and cause these things to break from the lives of people and see people being delivered in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. So I'd like us to go back to Colossians chapter 2. In Colossians chapter 2, thank you, Holy Spirit. In Colossians chapter 2, thank you, Lord. In Colossians chapter 2, I'd like us to do verse 14. In Colossians 2, verse 14, it said, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. He has taken out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Hallelujah. He has taken away those handwriting. He has nailed it to his cross. Look at verse 15. He said, and having spoiled principalities and power, he made a show of them openly and triumphing over them in it. You see, the victory of Jesus have become our testament. The victory of Jesus have become our testament, has become our will. In this will, we are free. In this will, we have liberty. In this will, we have dominion. In this will, we have power. So if you are born again, what Jesus has done should decide what you believe, what you think, what you say, and how you function. And if you function from the revelation of his finished work, you'll be expressing his power wherever you go. I believe that the finished work of Jesus should be what we should be preaching should be what we should be thinking, should be what we should express, no matter what the situation may be in the natural. The finished work of Jesus have already given us the victory, and our responsibility is to enforce the victory, is to say, well, Satan, you know, the victory of Jesus is my victory. Get out here in the name of Jesus. I cast you out in the name of Jesus. Because what the enemy wants to know, he wants to know if you really know. He doesn't want to assume that you know. So he comes against you. So you are the one to tell him, I know. Like what Jesus did in Matthew Gospel chapter 4, he said, it is written, it is written, it is written. The victory of Jesus was born out of his revelation, out of the revelation he has about what God have done, what God can do, and who God is. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Jesus spoke with authority and with power, and that was why this foul spirit bowed to him. He spoke to demons, how he commanded evil spirit to come out of people, because he was a man who had the revelation of the power of God that was in him, the power of God that was upon him, and the power of God that was coming out through him. And I believe that if you begin to see the finished work of Jesus, that Jesus have already fixed it, our responsibility is to enforce it, our responsibility is to live it out, our responsibility is to believe it, and then we're going to see great and mighty things. You can release the power of God. You can minister to people who are hurt, who have been oppressed, who have been abused, who are going through some health issues that is far beyond their human understanding. You can minister the power of God to them. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lamb of God. I pray for you today that you have an understanding. Satan cannot have his way in the life of the new creation. He cannot. Hallelujah. Because you have the Holy Ghost in you. He cannot. He may try to attack. He may try to do one thing or another. But you have authority over those things he's trying to do. Because God expects you and I to function from the finished work of Jesus. If you're watching this class today, this is just class one. We're going to continue in subsequent classes. I'm going to show up class two, class three, class four. As the Spirit of God will lead us, we'll be sharing some key things that will help you. If you're watching this broadcast today and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can say this after me. Lord Jesus, I confess with my mouth, I believe in my heart that God have raised Jesus from the dead. Thank you, Father, for saving me. Amen. If you pray that prayer with me, it means you're born again, and the Spirit of God will lead you from this day forward, and you will never remain the same. So I want to encourage you to subscribe to my YouTube channel. It's Faithman Teachings on YouTube. Is Faithman Teachings on YouTube, so subscribe to our YouTube channel. And also you can watch me every day on finishworktv.com. Finishwork TV stream 24/7, helping people around the world to receive the engrafted word of God. And also you can connect with us by partnership, by praying for this ministry and giving as the Spirit of God will lead you. You can partner with us by going to finishworktv.com/giving and give as the Spirit of God will lead you. As people give, it helps to reach out to more people to preach the gospel on multi-platform. Thank you for watching this broadcast. Until I come your way soon, please don't forget this. There is greatness in you, and Jesus is coming soon.